You see, real strategy requires cunning.
The Royal Court expansion is something we've never done before. There's two major main parts to the expansion. One is the Royal Court itself, the throne room, the scene where you can see yourself surrounded by courtiers and vassals, actually ruling, bridging the gap between your character and the map. And the other one is cultures, making the formerly static system dynamic, basing it on acceptance and creating dynamism and emergent cultures in the game. The Royal Court itself, your throne room, is accessed by kings and emperors that are either feudal or clan. The throne room itself is supposed to reflect your achievements. You collect grand court artifacts, maybe you employ powerful court positions, and you see it all reflected in the room itself, these objects actually being displayed on pedestals, or on the walls, or standing in the corners, furniture, statues, everything you can imagine. You can also choose to hold court, which is you inviting the vassals of the realm to air their grievances or come to you with petitions. And this can range from anything from a petty personality conflict to vassals that dislike each other to matters of governance, such as famines or active ongoing wars that you can decide upon. It all feeds into a system called grandeur, which is essentially a measurement of how famed your court is in the world. And if you're living up to the expectations put upon your court, to increase your grandeur, you have to spend money. And this is money you might want to spend on other things, so it's a balancing act. But there's also an expectation. If you're a small kingdom, your expectations will be very low. If you elect to exceed your expectations by spending more money on amenities, for example, then you will gain bonuses to many different things, such as prestige or renown. While if you decide to not spend as much as you need, if you're a big realm, let's say Byzantium or the whole Roman Empire, you might find yourself having very uppity vassals or courtiers that do not trust you at all. Court artifacts. They come in many flavors. There might be skulls of animals or swords, banners or statues. And where do you get these from? Well, you get them from inspired people. So the grander your court is, the more inspired people will elect to visit you. Someone that can give them the gold they need to complete their project. You don't really know what they want to do, and you elect to sponsor them or not. When you do, they will eventually give you something. Might be anything from the Ark of the Covenant to the skull of a particularly fierce rabbit. Some of these items will even be visible on your character when you're in certain situations, such as a duel. This marks the return of the inventory to Crusader Kings 3. Court positions, formerly known as minor titles in the previous iterations of Crusader Kings, for example, the court jester, bodyguards, champions, food tasters, cupbearers, seneschals, high almoners, they all provide a specific bonus to you, maybe something to themselves, and they come with a salary that you have to pay. Some of these are highly ceremonial, for example, the court musician or the court poet. They give you grandeur, so they are an alternative to spending on amenities. The jester, for example, might give you stress-reducing events. Your seneschal might help you increase control in your realm. The high almoner might increase your piety in the eyes of the world. And the champion might take your place in a duel, for example. Antiquarian looks after all of the artifacts you have, including court artifacts and personal artifacts. And having an antiquarian also allows you to reforge items that are on their last legs. So for a sum of money, you might be able to refurbish your grandfather's old sword so you can fight with it. Or you might even elect to put it in your court as a court artifact. Cultures are now modular, much like faiths are. They are made up of an ethos, pillars, and traditions. So the ethos is sort of the core cultural concept, the spirit of the culture. For example, you might have a steppe culture that is bellicose. They focus on warfare. This means that they have an easier time adopting traditions that have to do with warfare, but might be hampered when it comes to adopting traditions that have to do with agriculture, for example. Pillars are many different things. For example, what language the culture speaks or what heritage they have. Also, how they dress and how they build their buildings, their architecture, and many other things. Some of the pillars affect the acceptance they have towards other cultures. For example, if you speak the same language as another culture, you have a much easier time accepting them. Traditions are anything from how the culture fares in a certain climate to if they like to do mercenary work. But a tradition can do many things. Maybe certain cultures fight very well in jungles. They are jungle warriors. Maybe certain cultures are great at agriculture and do well in farmlands, but maybe they have a weaker military as a result of this life. This entire rework allows us to do something very exciting with the culture system. You will see dynamic cultures emerge during gameplay. And you will even be able to create your own divergent and hybrid cultures. A hybrid culture is a meld, a mix between two cultures. If you find yourself ruling a foreign culture, for example, if you are this Crusader king in Jerusalem, or if you're a Mongol conqueror from the steppe and you're now ruling Persia, you can build acceptance over time. And if you reach a certain level of acceptance, you can spend prestige to create a hybrid culture. When you do so, you pick and choose between the ethos and the pillars and the traditions of both cultures, creating something new. This happened a lot historically. For example, the Normans are a hybrid culture between Norse and French. And in turn, the English are a hybrid between the Normans and the Anglo-Saxons. The AI will naturally pursue hybrid cultures when it makes sense for them to do so. For example, if they've been ruling a realm without their culture in it for a very, very long time, maybe a few generations, they will attempt to build acceptance. And when they reach a certain threshold, they will attempt to create a hybrid culture. If you find yourself in a situation where your culture no longer really serves your needs, maybe you were bellicose, but now you're feudal and you're settled and you have no need for your warlike ways, you can choose to diverge your culture. Divergences represent major shifts in a culture. For example, you might see the Norse diverge into Swedish, Norwegian, and Danish, as they did historically. You might also see divergent cultures pop up dynamically in areas where two or more cultures meet. Acceptance and the rework of ethoses, pillars, and traditions is part of the free update that will be shipped alongside the Royal Court. We've really enjoyed making this expansion, and we put a lot of hard work into it. We hope it will help deepen and improve the immersion of your game experience.